Good morning. We welcome you to another time of worship here at Mississippi United Methodist Church. We appreciate y'all being here with us. And we hope that you're doing fine this wonderful morning. Let us begin our time with prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace, for your mercy, and for your love, Lord. We thank you, Father God, that no matter where we are, and no matter how things get, Lord, how bad things get, you always have us in your hand. You connect us through your spirit and your love and your grace. You make us one people of one mind and one accord, Lord God, that we may see you working no matter in our lives and the life of others, Father God. We see your grace, we see your love, and we see your peace. So we pray for these things, Lord God, now, that you would continue to bind us, Lord, through your spirit and through your love. Make us one people of one mind and one accord. As we gather this morning, Lord God, we pray that your spirit help us to worship you with everything we are and everything we have. Lord God, no matter what the world is doing, Lord, you are always constant. You are always there for us. So we pray, Lord God, for your hand this morning. We pray, Father, that you would help us to hear your word, to worship you with everything we are, and Lord God, that we could give you the things of last week, Lord, and set them down at the foot of the cross. And may we pick up your peace and your grace and your love. We thank you for this beautiful morning, Lord God. And we pray, Father, that your hand be upon us. In Jesus' name, amen. Good morning. I'm going to thank you all again for being here with us and participating in worship. And no matter where you are or what you're doing, I pray that you would lift your hearts and your minds to the Lord. Find with each other and let us worship God together. We are going to play a little song for you today just to kind of get us all in the mood of worship.
Great thou art.
Amen. We are going to do our affirmation of faith. If you would follow me, I'm in the page 81 of our hymnal. I don't know if maybe some of you may have them in front of you. So we're going to do affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered unto Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sit at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We hope that you would take some time, and maybe as you're sitting together, or if you're just sitting by yourself right now, to kind of take time and think about what God is doing in your life, and maybe in the life of others. And I really urge you that maybe through text or email or phone calls or faith, or however you want to do it, to share with each other what's going on in your all's lives, to connect, to continue to bind us together through the love of God in our connection, that you would share with each other needs, successes, whatever's going on. I would love to hear them, so please send them to me, and I will share them with each other. But one of the things that that for me are kind of going on is in our annual conference, right now is the time of pastors receiving the news if they're going to move or if they're going to stay. Of course, one of the praises from my life is that we are staying here another year. The church has accepted me again here in Mispah, so we will be here another year as a family, as hopefully to bolster your you guys and love you guys and help you to find your place in the hands of God. So we thank you, Ms. Fagan, for letting us be here another year of ministry. And also now to go on to our prayer time. If you have any requests that you would like for us to add to our list and tell everybody what's going on, please send those to me or Lori, if you have hers. To let us know what's going on and what are the needs that are happening in the community, and we can share those with each other. Just as an update, Ms. Gail is out of the hospital. I know some of you knew she went into the hospital to have an operation to take out a piece of her lung, and she came out. She's at home recovering from that. She's doing well. So there's others that you need me want us to know about, please send those to us through technology. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace, for your mercy, and for your love, Lord. Father, we open up our hearts and our souls and our minds, Lord God, to you today. Father, as one people of one mind and one accord, bound by your love and your grace, and your mercy, we pray, Lord God, now that you would hear us. Father, that you would come down and be present, Lord, as we lift up your people to you. Father, there are countless of cases of this COVID thing going around, Father. Those that have passed away, Father, we pray for their families, Lord, that you would comfort them, that you would help them through this time, Lord God. There are those that are right now in the hospitals, Father, dealing with this illness, Father, that and uncertainty and fear and all those things that come with that, Lord God. And one of the biggest things too right now, Lord, is being alone. Lord, we pray that your spirit be with them, that you touch them, Lord, that you surround them, Father, that even though they may not be present physically right there with them in the rooms, Father God, that your spirit will show them love. Show them, Lord God, that you have not left them alone and you are there with them. We pray for the families on the outside, Father, waiting to hear and to see things, Lord. We pray that you would be with them, Lord, that you would give them peace Give them grace and mercy, Father, but most of all, that you will let them know that you are loving them and watching over them. Father, this is a strange time. We don't know what's going to happen, how it's going to be after we get through this time, Lord, but we know that you will lead us through this time, through your grace and through your mercy. I pray, Lord God, that you would help us to rise, Father, to figure out new ways and better ways and different ways to be able to help others with your love and your grace and your mercy. To be present, Lord, maybe not physically, Lord, but through prayer, through communication, Lord, through just the want and desire to help others. So we thank you again, Lord God, for all that you do. And we pray, Lord, that you continue, Father. There are those in our community, Father, that we pray for, those in our heart and our mind. We lift up those prayers to you, Lord God, and we pray that you would help them, that you would lead them and guide them, Father God. And if it is for us to find a new way to do so, Lord, we pray for the vision, for the understanding, Lord, for the strength, for the words, and for the love. We thank you again for all that you do. We pray now like your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, we forgive those who have trespassed against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. All right, if you have your Bibles in front of you, I will ask you to follow me to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4, we're going to start at verse 8. Philippians 4, 8. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you.
Here I am to worship, here I am to I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin.
Amen. Good morning. Hope it's doing fine this wonderful morning. Week after Easter. It was wonderful to work our way to the time when we celebrate the coming of the Lord. I know it was a little different this year, but it still doesn't take away of what it means and how it prepared us and prepares us in how we receive God's grace in that moment. Today I wanted to talk to you about what's next. How do we proceed, right? The 40 days of Lent was a time of preparation to receive the coming of our Lord, right? To kind of introspect and see what's going on in our hearts and what are the things that we need to kind of let go of and prepare as we celebrate communion. So now, Easter, Resurrection Sunday. Now it's what happens next. As we commemorate Easter and the coming of our Lord and all the things that we receive and all the things that means and how that is a wondrous day. So now what? How do we proceed from that mountaintop experience that we had in Easter to come down to the valley and proceed with our lives? And the first thing I want to kind of bring to you is how we can have noble living. There was a devotional that me and my wife were doing that really brought this into my understanding and gave us an example of what that means, and we're going to get into it. But in the dictionary, noble means exalted moral or mental character or excellence. And I don't know what thought comes to you when I mention noble. Also, to me, when I was thinking of noble, it's nobility, right? The line of succession through kings and you know, being, you know, that kind of thing. But I think it's a little more than that. But let me start with that. You know, what would happen, if we watch a lot of TV shows and Hallmark channels, and there was one show where there's this guy that lives in Montana, and anyway, he has a relationship, way back in his history, where he's connected, he has a line to some kingdom out in the middle of Europe, right? So they come and get him, and he's from Montana, he's an older fella, and they put him in the middle of this kingdom, right, where he is now the king. So he has to operate in a different way, and so on and so forth. And the movie goes on from there. But what would happen if somebody came to you and said, you know, guess what? You have a line, right, a connection. So you now are a king. And how would that look? What would be that? And that's the thing that we have right now, is through Jesus Christ, we are made kings in his kingdom, kings and queens. We have a royal line connecting us to the beginning, to God himself, right? Through our acceptance of Jesus into our lives and us as his people, we are now in this line of kings. A noble line all the way to the beginning. And with all the rights and all the things that come with that, we are now kings. So being a king, and it, you know, just like with anything else, once you are something, once you have given that authority to something, then you must begin to live that way. And that is the thing that we need to begin to understand. First, we need to receive what God has for us. Like I've always said that. You have to receive what God gives you and become a king. What does that mean? Right? And it goes beyond, you know, the stuff that sometimes we think in our heads, right, with the riches and the, you know, and the power and all that. And I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about how do we begin to live? How do we begin to act? What changes in us for us to receive that kingship? What must change for us to be noble, to live in a noble life, to live in a noble existence, to exude our nobility, not in a kind of to put people down, but to exalt people? How do we begin to live a noble life? And that begins with example. When God came to his people in different instances, he, of course, the relationship between these people and God was strong. And I want to show something that was really stark to me when I read it. And God came and to certain people in our history and even to us, and he says, what do you want? You imagine if somebody came to you and said, doesn't matter anything, whatever you want, what do you want? And I'll give it to you. And when he came to his people and he asked the same question to Abraham, he asked him, what do you want? And he said, help me follow you. Right? To Moses, Moses said, help me free your people. To David's request was, help me slay the giant that's threatening your people. Esther said, help me save your people. Solomon says, give me wisdom to rule your people. Isaiah said, give me clean lips to speak your word. Peter said, help me feed your sheep. And Jesus, help me show them your love. Noble requests from noble people, because they understood what it meant to be in a relationship with God. Now, they could have asked anything they wanted. You know, they could have, you know, said, hey, give me money, give me power, give me whatever. And none of them chose those things of this world. They chose God's kingdom. Because he understood that when you asked
God for something that God wants to give you anyway, he's going to help others. They weren't concerned with themselves. They understood that God's going to take care of us, period. But when God asks us, what do you want? What do you want to do? These people chose the noble way. To live a noble living is to give ourselves up to God and what he wants for us to do. And that's to help others. To help others find their place in his hands. To help us find a place in his hands through helping others. See, the noble thought is always God's way. That's what it means to have a noble living. Is to always focus on what God wants us to do for him and for his people. And we need to find that spot where we can begin to turn ourselves over to God and begin to have a noble intention, a noble thought, a noble want or desire in our hearts, then to proceed to put that into action. Now, we understand all these people are that I just talked to, Abraham all the way through Jesus Christ, right? It's easy to just see them, you know, now and with our eyes as somebody unattainable, you know, these great people of the Bible, great people of history, good Christians. But you need to understand something. They were just people. In their time, they weren't, you know, they were just people. They were just these people that were going about their lives every day, and God called them. They chose a relationship with God, to worship God, to follow God, to be in his presence, but they were just people. You know, it's easy to look at our history and in the Bible and see these greater than, you know, just great people, right? But the thing is, they all had their issues, right? They all had their issues. You know, if you read the stories of each person, you know that each person had an issue that they didn't totally and utterly follow the plan, but their intention was right and good, and they repented and came back to God, right? Moses kept on saying, hey, I can't speak, man. I can't speak. You know, he kept on putting things in front of him. You know, Esther was afraid. They were just people, just like us. We're just people. We go on and we try to live the best we can. But the thing is, in ourselves, we're never going to reach anything. But when our desire to live a noble life, to live our life in God, overrides, can and will override anything and everything, our fear, our doubt, you know, whatever. But we have to give ourselves up to God. And then we can begin to have a noble intention, a noble life, that our desire to serve God, to help others, begins to override anything and everything. And God is waiting for us to ask for his help. You know, in every one of these stories, as soon as they spoke what they needed and wanted to God, it happened. And they began to move towards that goal, towards what it is that they needed to do. They began to move towards it. And that's just the way that God helped and is with us. So how do you do that? How do you do that? You give yourself up to God first, right? And the more you spend time with him, the more you pray, the more you serve, the more you study, the more you understand, right? The more you do those things. And this is not something that is, you know, mind-boggling, some kind of, you know, thing. It's just the normal stuff. You know all this. You have to give yourself up first. Make that choice. Begin to change the way you think, the way you understand, the way you see, the way you speak. And let God lead you and guide you and figure out what it is that you want and ask God specifically for that thing. Lord, help me to love others more. Lord, help me to see, help me to have vision that I may lead your people to your hands, whatever it may be. And if you notice, each person had a different purpose. Each person asked for a different thing that needed to be done. So all of us have our own purpose. God has put us in this world to do something. And I know right now it's kind of weird, you know. I'm coming through you through the technology, right? The one-on-one person connection thing may be a little different moving on from here, okay? But that shouldn't stop us. It's something to get around and over and through and figure out, absolutely. But it shouldn't stop you from beginning to have noble intentions and noble thoughts, to live a noble life, to live how God wants you to live, to help others find their place and find peace and help and move things forward. That is a noble life. That when people think or see or hear about what you're trying to do or how you're trying to live and what you're trying to accomplish, that they understand that your intention is nobility. That comes from deep inside of you. To love others, to help others, to live for God, to help God help you touch their lives. It's a little different right now in this time. And I think we're going to have to figure out new ways in which to reach out. But it's happening. You can see it in our community. It's happening. So give yourself up to God. Let God touch you. Begin to change how you think and how you see, how you speak, and what you want. What do you want? How can you accomplish what God has called you to do? Ask Him for it. Be specific. And understand, God loves you. And you have a purpose in this life. And you have things to do and things to accomplish and people to help. Let's begin to organize our lives that we may have a life of nobility, that we may be noble in our intention, in our speech, in our thought, in our desires, that we give them up to God. Let Him help us reach others and touch them and move forward. Amen. I love you. Thank you very much. If you need me, connect through me through text or email or however you need to get in contact with me. Receive the benediction. Go forth in the power and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May you give up to Him that He may make your life noble, that you may touch others. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.